Why hello everyone and welcome to the second best of five in the EU CSQ Spring Finals. I'm Richard Pulse-Cam and joining me for this match between Fnatic Academy and Team Forge is James Stress-O'Leary. How are we today, James Stress-O'Leary?
Great, 2017, first cast of the new year, and this is going to be a good win. These two teams have been looking super, super strong, perhaps up until yesterday, but we'll get into Fnatic Academy as we get through these matchups.
Yes, we will. And let's take a look at those lineups, of course. Starting with the team you just mentioned, it will be Fnatic Academy with their top lane Kickers, jungle Broxah, with their mid lane Niski, ADC, Mr. Rallez, a name known to many, along with his support, Kalai.
And we got to look at kind of how this team got here. You know, from the OQ, they were EUS third place team, and we alluded to yesterday, and Vedi and Pyra talked about it before the break, they actually had a bit of a crushing loss where they were looking so strong, and then up against NERV just didn't really find their footing. And, you know, when you look at this team, they're all mid to upper tier players. Even when you start looking at LCS standards, I mean, I know a lot of people will kind of be like, ooh, are you sure on that? But you look at, you know, Kickers pedigree, Rallez pedigree, at least in that mid echelon of LCS names. So this team should really be able to get to Challenger.
Yeah, especially when you compare their names to perhaps their opponents as well. And we'll take a look at them. It will be Team Forge, a name known to people. If you have been watching EUCS, they were in the last split, of course, took the fifth and sixth place, which means they are now here with their top lane Bintou, jungle Taiki, mid lane Jazuke, with ADC Garry and support Mokka.
As you said, fifth, sixth in CS, they ended up losing their support Heva, who, you know, when we look at challenger teams, Heva always kind of shapes a team. His aggression in the bottom lane was always a massive, massive part. But, you know, they've now brought in a different bottom lane, Garry and Mokka. Yep. They come from the Korean Challengers League. Last time we saw them together was actually Spring 2016. So I don't know how many of our viewers watch Korean Challengers, but certainly they have a little bit of experience together.
Yeah, I just feel like the identity of this team will change so much. It's difficult to say how they'll perform if they make it to EUCS. But even up against Fnatic Academy, a team who have just looked incredible, as you said, up until yesterday. But even yesterday was like a surprising loss. It was a very fast game as well up against NERV. And we just saw NERV get annihilated 3-0 in our last series. So it's very difficult to tell actually how these teams will match up when the pressure's on in these final games.
And that's the funny thing is so many people have been talking about, you know, all of the import slots, everything like that. Like so many people now are talking about Ruin and his performance over the last series where everyone's saying, well, he was playing against worse players. I was seeing a lot of like journalists on Twitter talking about, you know, he was facing worse competition. So now I'm excited to see the same for Garry and Mokka. Like, does that hold up in the same extent? Like, is a European, you know, pedigree AD carry from LCS previously going to be able to take on a Korean challenger? Like, in my estimation, yes. I feel like Rallez should be very comfortable in this matchup.
You think so? Because there's the whole old debate of, oh, you know, Korea greater than everybody else in the world. And when you hit challenger, what's next? Oh, yeah, Korean bronze 5. But when you actually, like, look at the leagues over there, it's like, actually, does that compare? Because if you look at, like, the top levels of play, of course, you see international competition. You see the top teams beating the top teams out of the other players. But if you take a look at the lower leagues, like Challenger, does that actually stack up? And that's what we'll probably find out here today. So far, seen pretty good things from them up until this point, though, in this tournament.
Yeah, that's very true. So, again, it's such an interesting dichotomy with some players that we've seen for so long, some new players coming in. I mean, for Challenger, we've got a lot of names that we've seen a lot. Jazuki, Taiki, both names that have been around a long time. Bintou, you mentioned it already. I mean,
he's been around for yonks.
Like. If you've been watching even since like 2013, you've seen Bintou time and time again. So again, it's that kind of mix where I'm really excited. And we haven't even really talked about Kickers.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah, Kickers, kind of a big name when you come into Challenger. He had that whole old thing that was just like 21 teams in 21 months. And now he swapped another couple times after joining LCS, of course. Wasn't Unicorns of Love, then moved again, and is now in the Challenger squad for Fnatic. But we're about to get into Champion Select here, and indeed we are getting into this one. So we'll talk a little bit about the teams later, but more about how the meta has been shaping up, because it's been very different in this one.
So we've got one very meta ban with Camille being taken away now from red side. Importantly, Lee Sin for Bozar was one of his biggest picks just throughout the CSQ up until this point. So taking that away, it was a very good pick in the first four games for him. Did very well for Fnatic Academy.
Yeah, we saw it banned away yesterday, actually, in the loss that they had. They just took away the Lee Sin. It's just like, oh, you played this in every single game, in every single win that we've had. Just take that away and then see what else you have in the bank. and it didn't work out so well for them. So taking the same blueprint from what they saw yesterday, 4G will try and get this win again against Fnatic by banning that one away.
And with Forge putting presence on mid lane, perhaps that's where the Ryze will come in a little bit here. We've seen so much Ryze come time and time again, people still complaining every so often. Ika tweets about, you know, how OP Ryze is, that kind of thing. I always see it on Twitter, whereas Fnatic Academy going for the a little more jungle focus. Now that the Lee Sin's off the table, they take away the Rengar, they take away the Ivan as their last ban, so maybe in their first rotation, that's where they're going to look for Broza.
Well, there's that Ryze first pick, as you were just mentioning, and see what Fnatic will lock in for their first two picks. We have the Poppy confirmed for Kickass, and also the Zyra coming into the bot lane. Again, just a very staple support we've been seeing over the last couple days and weeks.
And the staple top laner as well right now in that Poppy. I mean, everyone is complaining about how good Poppy is right now, and you know, we have seen evidence of that across all levels of play, really. So difficult to deal with, so I think this is a very solid pick. It fits Kickass' playstyle, where you can put him on something that is tanky and still is able to be disruptive and a bit of damage coming out there. So I like this first setup from Fnatic Academy. The response from Forge, a little bit of a throwback to Worlds.
Yeah, Misfortune again coming out, still seen as a pretty decent pickup against Zyra, specifically in that matchup. I know you at home, I know a lot of people were just like, oh, Misfortune support, that's a thing now, and just brought it to solo queue and ruined a lot of people's games. Just pick it against Zyra, and even then, it's not like a surefire win. It's just decent into those matchups for a variety of reasons. Ashe locked in, another staple of the ADCs recently. We've seen the power of Ashe we saw in the last series, and also when Willite was playing it, less so much of that power, because if you constantly miss those arrows, a lot of the kind of power just goes down the toilet, you know?
Yeah, that is definitely, definitely for sure when you look at Ashe, if you can't hit them. But anyway, as we look into the next rotation, likely jungle coming out from Fnatic as they ban two, or they're going to look for, you know, a little more
you
damage.
You could have waited for like another 2 seconds and be like, maybe the mid lane
but
coming
thinking,
out here.
Like, Elise is available right now, so wouldn't that make sense as a pick here? My initial thought, but clearly not the case.
That's why you do the lead up first before saying the role, and then, you know.
I could have pivoted away.
Exactly. Give me some wiggle room, yeah. But the Ezreal locked in there along with the Cassiopeia for the mid lane up against Instant Ryze. And Ralez, again, was a very strong AD carry, actually, bouncing between a lot of kind of lower tier teams, actually, in the LCS, despite always performing in his role.
Yeah, always performing, a lot of respect from a lot of players. Generally just solid. Never really became the top tier AD carry, you know, that mentioned in the, you know, the same breath as, you know, Sven or Forgiven, that kind of echelon, but still very, very successful in his own right. So with the Ezreal now, obviously playing slightly later on in the game, but fair amounts of damage down in that bottom lane between both teams, actually, when you look at the MF, the Zyra coming out. So interested to see how the bot lane pairing is going to work out.
Lots of damage across the board, and they're rounding out with some tanks, of course, because it wouldn't be you know, a 6.24 meta without tanks coming into a lineup. So Maokai into that top lane for Beansu, and Trundle will go into the jungle for Taiki. Typically you don't see the troll in the jungle, but it's a Taiki special, so if you watch Taiki for a little bit, you'll know that he likes to pick that one into the jungle role.
Yeah, he likes us bringing that out, likes the damage that it provides, the setup for team play a little bit alongside with that pillar coming through. So interested to see now, obviously, being able to shred away some of the tank status, but you look at it, it's a Poppy on the other side. So yes, that will help a little bit with this lineup now with the Elise locked in.
You're just ahead of your time there, Stress. Elise finally locked in there for Fnatic.
Well,
so got a prediction, that's what counts.
As I guess there's a lot of jungle fans.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah, considering the amount of junglers being banned away there.
It was either that or Rek'Sai coming through. And considering the playmaking that Broza has been, you know, pulling out, I was like, ah, Elise is probably the way to go on this.
Yeah, absolutely. In terms of just setting things up by yourself, because a lot of the time Rek'Sai is the one who is both setting up lanes for a lot of her team. We saw that actually in IEM back in Korea when I was casting that. We saw a lot of Rek'Sai and Lee Sin. Those were the top tier junglers back in that tournament. And we saw a lot of Jhin as well paired alongside that. So moving a little away from that, definitely with the Trundle pick in the jungle, but this will be our second best of five today. We already have one team locked into EU Challenger for 2017 Spring. And just kind of based on these two compositions and also the two teams as well, who are you expecting to pick up this series, Stress?
Looking at the team alone, I think I'm expecting Fnatic Academy, but this first game, you look at Forge, they've picked up, you know, the Maokai, they've got the Ryze as well as a big pick. and a fair amount of team fight to go along with it. So I actually quite like Forge's comp. When you look at this, you know, how 624 has evolved into a lot of diving and fighting and that kind of thing rather than sitting back. So Fnatic Academy, if they can get themselves a little bit ahead and withhold some of the team fight presence, I think they should be able to do fairly well with the Poppy, the Cassiopeia, the Ezreal, that kind of setup.
Well, those are stressful thoughts, but jump on Twitter and shoot your own over to us using the hashtags 4GWin and FNAWin. Tell us what you're thinking. Who will pick up this series? Who will win this best of five? And who will even take game one? Because Team Forge's composition is very good because of all those reasons you mentioned. We'll see who will reign supreme in game one between 4G and Fnatic in this best of five. We're on to Drift.
Beansu's a little bit late. Hasn't taken his Christmas tree down. That's bad luck if you're from the UK.
You've got 12 days to do it. Yep.
Ah, Beansu. I know there wasn't much competition over Christmas period, but nevertheless.
Is that just a UK thing? Because I know in the train station near me, they still have all the Christmas lights up. And I'm like, wait, is that...
At this point, just leave them up for the whole year.
That's true. We're just 300 days early. Don't even worry about it.
So, spread out across the map. This is a blast from the past, and also what people have been doing a little bit on 624. It's been interesting to see how the evolution of level ones has kind of changed and that sort of thing. Always drifts between defensive and aggressive. And I'm interested now on the changes that we're going to see in LCS as well, whether those teams will end up doing more. But certainly 624, we've seen a whole host of different things, from level ones to crazy picks to everything. So with a best of five, we'll see how it evolves. We'll track it throughout each game.
That we will. And Camille was banned away in the series. Really want to cast some Camille. But she's been played all over the place as well. Top lane, mid lane, jungle. But this is kind of more from what we saw in 2-3. And even before that, of course, you were throwing back to Worlds, seeing that misfortune pick up. So in terms of picks, not seeing anything massively crazy. But
I like this start. Brozard takes the two small wolves, then moves on to the already started blue buff from Klai. So just trying to get a little bit more acceleration through the jungle early on. You can see, look at this, just comboing the camps all the way through the bottom jungle. Really nice by Fnatic Academy. Making sure that they can get Broza all the way to level three.
That's a jungler's dream right there.
2 minutes. He's coming bot. Like, Broza is already coming down towards the bot lane. This is something that is, you know, highly unexpected at this point. Look at how Garry and Mokka are pushing because of the way the lane was in their favor early on. Broza, if he can slip down into the bottom of this lane, right, maybe
make a bold prediction. Gonna be at least some summer spells burnt in the next couple seconds here. Stress Broxar down into the bottom lane, looking for that vision onto Mokka and Garry. Klai closing the noose as well. Rallaz coming down. Might snare onto Mokka. Well, the flash after that will be the kill over to Rallaz. The heal up as well. Garry taking a lot of punishment on the way out, and he'll have to take a trip back to base. First blood to Fnatic.
Very nice start out for Fnatic. Gets Mr. Rallaz all the way ahead here. Three summoners apiece, but the real important thing is that kill going over. You know, it's so difficult to anticipate an Elise sitting in the back of the lane waiting for the minion line to pass and then coming in. What it does give Taiki is a bit of a farm advantage on the top side, but Brozar's going to even it up himself. He's predicting the invade. Despite the fact that, you know, Forge are trying to compensate for this as best as possible, it should end up kind of still being in Fnatic Academy's favor.
Yeah, a really big snowball play coming out of Fnatic here, and this was something that was triggering a lot of people in the bot lane. It was just like, ah yes, jungler ganking at level 3 when I'm still level 1. Very nice game. And Broxar just putting that into very good effect there. That was also something that you probably could have thought was maybe happening if you were the bottom lane of Team Forge. It's just like, ah, Mr. Rallaz and Klai not in the bot lane yet. This is not solo queue. They have definitely connected to the game, so they must be doing something in the jungle. Ah yes, there's the jungler, I'm dead. So, pushing up, maybe not the smartest of things to do. But here's another gank into the mid lane. Nice flash into the cocoon onto Dazuki. He'll flash away, but his death is already sealed. Rappel comes up for the vision, and that's another kill. Second kill of the game to Fnatic.
This game could not have started much better for Fnatic Academy right now. When you look at it, you've got your Ezreal a kill, you've got your Cassiopeia a kill. These are the two members of this team that needed to get going just to make sure they could keep up in the team fights. You know, everything seems to be going their way right now, and Taiki hasn't been able to do anything to stop Brozar on his way around the jungle. Perfect flash into the mid lane, into the cocoon. Really nice setup. Forge, we've seen a lot out of them. We need to see them maybe pick up the pace a little bit in this one, try and get back into it.
Well, apparently there is more to Broxah than just the Lee Sin from what we've seen. And already 0-2. Double tiers picked up from Fnatic. Another one in the mid lane from Jazuki as well. Honestly, most of the tiers are on Team Fortress' side as they have already dropped 2 kills and are 1,000 gold down at this stage in the game. So that's an Elise who's pretty big. Aether Wisp picked up as well at just 4 minutes. Taiki probably doesn't want to get involved in that fight.
No, not for now. really doesn't want to get too close to Broxah at the moment. Good start, and you see Kigis going to be able to shove the wave out. Will be answered with the TP from Beansu. For the top lane, it's a Maokai lane, so...
That it is.
Basically, Kigis is going to hold the lane for a long time, and then Maokai is going to have impact in team fights. So there's really not too much to go catastrophically wrong for Forge, unless Beansu ends up getting camped. But speaking of camped, Jazuki may... May have been in trouble.
The Juke back in, and there's luckily minions, the melee minions there for Broxah to jump to, but Jazuki, the old double bait where you think I'm going to juke, but actually I just carry on running in a straight line.
It's in his head.
Yeah, right in his head. So not fazed by that first initial gank. Taiki picking up the Tiamat on his first back, so he'll be clearing the jungle pretty quickly. Very common for the junglers to do something like that nowadays, that or the Sheen or something just to help the early clear versus the jungle items. On the opposite side, just Broxah going back through his jungle. Continuing to farm before he looks for his next gank, maybe even looking towards that first dragon of the game. Be taking away the honey fruit. And maybe looking for another return gank on the mid lane. He hasn't seen Taiki in a while, and he'll just see him as he turns around the corner. Double wards placed down by both teams. And Taiki will head onto the bottom side of the map. Kickers, bit of trading in the top lane. But past the first couple levels, it's very rare for anything really to happen in this 1v1 matchup. I love talking about tanks and how the little intricacies could sway how the top lane goes, but unfortunately in this one, the past level 6, so nothing's going to happen. Nice steal there from Broxah, and Niski also helping his jungler out. Just overall, it feels like Fnatic have pretty good control over this game. Lots of wards placed down. 4G trying to maintain some control on the top side as well of those wards.
And by the looks of it, Fnatic want to turn this into a fairly fast first Infernal. I mean, if there's two champions, they're going to be able to bounce the aggro very effectively between, you know, external factors, the plants, the spiderlings, everything. Meanwhile, top lane, Taiki's looking for Kickers. Doesn't really get too much from this. Gets the ult. That will obviously be a cooldown used, but Kickers didn't use his TP. So ended up getting back to lane fairly safely. That's an Infernal Drake going over to Fnatic Academy again, continuing this great start.
Yeah, big win really there for Fnatic. Burns basically Kickers' ult for a dragon. So be very happy with that result. As you said, teleport also there. So if he wants to make a bot lane play, also available for them.
And because of the leads that Fnatic managed to accrue early on, as Gary gets caught out here.
Ooh.
A lot of damage down. Fnatic have actually had a couple of good back timings. You can see that Ezreal, Miserales actually got another back after that initial kill, picks up the Sheen for himself, and has maintained a slight CS lead because of how far ahead they got in the laning phase. The same can be said for Niski. He got back, ended up going back buying the mana item. Jazuki hasn't even backed yet. He's been under pressure, has, you know, about 1,400 gold in his inventory right now. So it just means that Fnatic Academy, they're safe in their lanes, they've got the dragon control from it as well, and they're in a good spot.
And they are. Taiki will try and even up the playing field as he heads into the bottom lane. Unfortunately, his ADC may just die to a plant in the backside. Doesn't have the Warlords there healing him just a little bit, but Taiki can't even get close. Kalai had those plants set up, and he'll bring them up and force Taiki back into his jungle.
Rales hit 6. Can he line it up? He's going for it.
Ooh. Oh! Well, Gary. He hit one of the goalposts. And the heal was popped
heal,
as well,
yeah.
There you go. It was a little panicky. Saw the banana flying through the air, did not want any of that potassium. Ooh, last Q, almost finishing off Gary.
Gotta be careful, because Rales could very easily E forward and then just look for it, but obviously would have to then burn his flash to get out. In fact, he's just gonna maybe let Broxah do this, because Broxah is around. They can't disrupt the recall, so it's gonna end up being okay. Broxah walks over a ward, has that control ward to clear it out as well. In fact, it was a control ward he was clearing. So Fnatic now get damage onto the tower. Everything just going very well on the bottom half of the map.
Pretty much textbook play out from Fnatic from the start of the game with that little bit of a swap up for that first gank in from Broxah, and it's just play after play has just been working out for them.
And this is a really painful position to be in for Gary right now. He's gone for the level 2 boots already. His damage is going to be so heavily delayed. He will get some time to farm if Fnatic don't go elsewhere on the map and just let him sit bot lane. But Fnatic Academy, I mean, I expect them to now punish this. If they can, you know, move into the mid lane, move to other lanes, get more towers down, because this is a fairly early first tower down in that bottom lane, stemming obviously from those initial kills. So Garry needs a lot of time to get back into this game, and I don't feel like Forge's team fighting is anywhere near where it needs to be right now. Ryze is behind the curve as well.
We never really saw those plays in the bottom lane, because one of the devastating things you see out of an Ashe Misfortune lane is just that, oh, there's an arrow onto Zyra, and then the ult combo just, like, kills her.
Yeah.
But up until that point, they were just getting decimated underneath their tower, so they couldn't really set up that play. Now it is level 6, and the ADC isn't there anymore.
And there's a couple of other little things that play into this. I mean, one of the big strengths of Misfortune was being able to utilize the double tap and hit the Zyra and, you know, combo it off the plants and get that additional damage. So not only did Klai buy boots early so he could kind of maneuver around the lane a lot more, Mokka was so far back in the lane they could never punish the attempted plant usage from Klai. So it's this really difficult lane where you want to try and push forward to punish and can't really afford to. Ralez, they had a ward in there, so he's just saying, hey, I know where you are. You're sitting around. We're not going to get caught out by that. And again, maintains the CS lead right now.
And ultimately has not meant anything for the top lane, but the mid laners, Niski picked up that first kill, and he's just been farming away. Has a healthy CS lead. It's nothing exceptional, but is leading in that mid lane and building towards his items. Just kind of has a pick and mix of items right now, hasn't really finished anything up, but Klai now rotating to this mid lane, getting all this vision over this area, about 3 minutes until the next dragon spawn. So
look at where Kickers is coming as well here. They're just looking to put the pressure on. Again, they're looking to just force Jazuki back away from the tower, put damage down, get wards around the inside of the jungle. This is what you'll see teams commonly do. It was one thing that a lot of the North American casters were talking about, what TSM like to do is transfer lane advantages into vision advantages and force people back away from turrets, steal away buffs. And with the blue buff coming up fairly soon for Forge, I wonder whether that'll be a point of contention. But Fnatic Academy are heavily focused down on the bottom side of the map.
That they are. Ralez clearing out those wards as well, and it's really just Team Forge scrambling for vision in the bottom side of the map, or pretty much anywhere, because it's quickly being taken out. Garry with a sidestep there on Broxar's cocoon. So we'll be living to see another day, but the Spineling will follow him down.
Doesn't even need to land the cocoon and takes a third of his health off. So it's a tough time to be down in that bottom lane for Garry and Mokka. Mokka tried to venture out, but is going to instantly have his vision control cleared away.
That's not a great life for Garry. I wonder if we're ever going to get to the time where everyone just has really mundane names like Steve in the top lane and Garry in bot lane with Dave in mid lane. Like, that would just be a great team. That would just be fantastic. And the names aren't even like Steve as well. Oh. I think his name's Garry. Oh, Jazuki, he's running after them. He still has the round warp, but unfortunately the arrow went wide.
Oh, that was a painful sequence. Just from the way the arrow went wide, Jazuki used his ghost. Teleport was attempted by Binsu, forced to cancel it because they didn't hit any of the setup for the fight. So for Fnatic Academy, they got so much out of Forge there. And they got damage down on the turret. I mean, this is going to sound like I'm a broken record talking about how good Fnatic Academy are doing right now. And honestly, it's hard to argue
against how this
game is going. It's only game one of a best of five. But this has been a great start.
Yeah,
I want to see more from Forge, though.
For sure. And we were praising their composition as well, right? Like, they had a pretty decent draft coming into this one. So if there is a game that they're going to win against Fnatic Academy, it could definitely be this one. And we haven't even seen the top laners get involved just yet. So until we get to those team fights, it's difficult to call it.
And you know, soon when Binsu hits two items, when Jazuki hits two items, Ryze and Maokai are going to be so difficult to kill if ever they're in, you know, that small numbers situations. Sure. They have a lot of damage output at the same time, so there's going to be that interesting dichotomy when Forge start fighting to see whether Fnatic Academy can keep up with it. Oh, and speaking of keeping up with it, Kickers is keeping up with three for now, but he is going to fall.
Yeah, it was an okay flash, but in the end, it didn't really help him out with too much. May have been able to dodge a couple more things, but for the most part, a lot of what was going on in the top lane was point and click, so couldn't really dodge that. Top lane will go down to Team Forge. Nice play there. Mid lane was shoved in. That's the outer turret going down. So in terms of towers for towers, mid lane tower, a lot more valuable than the top one for now.
But the next attempt as well from Fnatic Academy is using that vision control to come down to the bottom side. So the tower trade for now is even. But this is going to result in further damage down onto bottom side as Ralez is looking for Garry. Mokka will come across as well. But here comes Broxar.
Turns that corner. Gets blown up by Jazuki. Nice play there from the mid laner. was not really what he was looking for. And he will go down, and that's the entire play from Fnatic wiped away.
That's what Forge needed. They needed Jizuki to start getting extra kills here. He got the one earlier, and now as Broxah was trying to come down through the jungle, was trying to come in through the back door of the tower. There were only three minions in front, and they were looking to dive Garry and Mokka, but didn't have a real read on where Jizuki was. Didn't even use his ultimate to get there. That was just him just running there from the base. So, you know, a little bit of an overstep by Fnatic Academy. They had a good lead. It has somewhat been evened out by Forge.
I mean, that was a Merc Treads Elise as well, but it was a level 8 versus a level 11. Very angry Ryze who full comboed him to death, and he is even critting for a lot of damage with those Qs even at this stage in the game.
I know you normally play top lane. Have you played against Ryze?
Against Ryze? Yeah, it's not a fun experience.
It's not fun.
I mean, Cassiopeia is one of the better matchups if you did have to pick one. But yeah, if Ryze happens to hit you with an overload in the late game, you're pretty much dead. Like, he will crit you for 1.6k, something around that. And that's like basically an ADC's health bar, so it's not a great experience.
It's okay, I'm okay, I'm dodging. Oh, I didn't dodge the Q.
Yeah, it's like, well, okay.
Half my health gone. And that's on one item of the Rod of Ages, so.
The biggest thing about playing against Ryze is knowing how he works, knowing what parts of his combos to try and dodge or flash away from, because it really is really loaded on that one. Here comes Taiki trying to get this kill onto Kalai. The flash away may not save him, and will indeed not. Taiki taking a lot of damage, Rallis, though. Might be the return kill. Rallis in there with a one-for-one trade. Moving on to Garry. The plant helping after the death as well. Rockstar comes in with the execute damage. Mokka getting chased down. The repel comes out. Neurotoxin is enough for that kill. That'll be a 3-for-2 favor Fnatic.
It looked like Forge was, you know, setting the trap. They got the initial setup and took out Klai. Klai managed to hold them for just long enough. Didn't actually use his exhaust. Maybe it wasn't up for the early onset of that fight, but Rallis going aggressively towards Garry as soon as he knew that he was already dead. Jizuki's core.
Very nice play from Nitsuki, finding that right time to use the ultimate. He's taken down from the poison. Oh, kick is from nowhere. Blindsided by the Poppy. Beansu's getting chased down here, but he is pretty tanky and does have his flash. Maybe they'll get that one away from him. That'll be the W's. Courage of the Colossus. She opened the flash over the wall from Nitsuki. He wants blood. He wants sap. That'll be the kill. 2-0 to Fnatic. Nice two picks in there in the mid lane.
And just as Forge were picking back up, they tried to make a play on the bottom side. Didn't actually bring Beansu into the play. And I would be interested to see what the interaction with Beansu and Kickers was before that whole play started. I wonder whether it would have been a teleport situation at the bottom lane. They were obviously afraid of Kickers as well. But, you know, Broxah makes the initial difference early on. Now Mokka again caught by Kickers.
Not the place he wanted to be. Luckily, the buckler was down, so Kickers can't follow him after. And there was no ranged characters available. But that would be the flash down for Mokka regardless. All the jungle camps taken away from Team Forge. Taiki not having a great day currently. And Fnatic still with this pretty big gold lead and just map advantage in general.
Yeah, they snatched back control with those last two plays, and Rallis from it has a very clear goal in mind. Automatically ran top lane from the base, will be pushing down this tower, so again, more objectives going in their focus. So much of this vision control that was just set up by Fnatic Academy helps this out. They know that they can easily take this as nobody is returning to topside. So again, it's just kind of moving from lane to lane with the vision control. There have been mistakes by Fnatic Academy. That attempt in the bottom side by Broxah to try and go behind the turret. Yeah. So it's certainly not over yet, but Fnatic Academy have themselves a good lead.
But for every mistake that Fnatic have made, it's followed up by two really good plays. It's like, okay, we'll try something really risky, but then we'll get some punishes, we'll make a good play. Kickers will jump onto Garry in the bottom lane, and look at all the damage that Garry is not doing to Kickers right now. There's an ultimate used, and they've got three people closing in, so it might be enough damage. He's going to flash away behind the tower.
No.
That was a lot of resources used on the Poppy who didn't even die. However, might result in this tower, though.
Well, Mr. Ryze... No, okay, with Jizuki coming as well, they can't really afford to push forward. As soon as he's envisioned that, pretty much signals the tower going down. That was a Trundle ult used. That was an Ash
that
Arrow.
That should be a weakened Poppy already. Ash Arrow, wailing on the Poppy for a good 15 seconds.
That's a one and kind of like two sets of halves of items on a Poppy as well. So that's a good thing to have happen. I mean, we can also play that Garry has been behind the curve on his itemization.
True.
Just from how the laning phase played out. He has been able to kind of maintain at least the old CS gap of about 15 between the two, but still is behind the curve. Not making excuses for why Kickers is taking literally no damage in that exchange.
Pretty much. That's not even the best part of Poppy as well. The ultimate will come into these team fights, and that will get so much gold out of the fight. That was a really good way to analyze how strong and how much gold value goes into Poppy ult, is how many people you hit from it and get them out of the fight, because that's so much gold down the toilet when you go into a team fight and it's like, oh, now it's a 5v3, and that's like 20,000 gold down when you're in a late game team fight. But we're looking towards this dragon now.
Ooh, Beans is coming through.
Cutting them off, but this is forcing the fight for Fnatic. Big ultimate in from Mokka. Unfortunately, he just does no damage. And that's two fast kills over to Fnatic. Did lose Klai in the crossfire.
Kick is coming around the back here, though. He's going to try and catch Jazuki, but he's on his own. Fnatic Academy, they're looking to collapse.
Finds the sun against the wall. Jazuki going to walk away from this one. Beansu knocked up in the air. Barakzar following up with the damage. But for all the damage that Kickers doesn't take, neither does Beansu. He's been farming in the top lane just as much. However, Dragon Control over to Fnatic. That'll be another one over to them. That third one of the game, in fact, to Fnatic. Just 20 minutes.
It's also quite funny, though, because you look at how Poppy is itemized. Kickers itemizing completely not for the lane outside of his boots here. So Beansu actually ends up doing more damage to him because of the lack of magic resist on Poppy right now. So Gary doesn't scratch him, but Maokai, you can hit a Q on there. Jazuki gets a little bit of damage out too as well. So going over to Fnatic Academy. So that's a second Infernal Drake coming through for them. And again, they're going from strength to strength. There's these flashes from Forge that are keeping them in the game, but certainly still Fnatic Academy are dictating the pace.
Glimpses of hope, really, from Team Forge. And here we'll see all of that damage, of course, coming out from Beansu. But something the casters were saying up until this point out of CSQ was Fnatic, very good one ahead. And you can clearly see it in this game. Once they have an advantage, they instinctively know what to do next. It's like, okay, we'll convert this mid lane pressure. We'll go top lane. We have the vision down already. It's just play after play after play. Really well done. However, when they're on the back foot, that's when problems start coming into the equation. Flash over the wall from Jazuki. That was the one that you wanted to dodge, really. But Flash had already been used from Klai. Jazuki picking up another kill. And he is the carry that the team really needs.
He is. Like, so much of this game is now on Jazuki. So with the Ash Arrows, we're going to need to see them connect. Beansu, the last teleport was pretty good, but the team kind of couldn't quite get them boxed in. So Jazuki, 4-2 right now.
Scoreline is lit.
Yeah.
Beansu pushing down the bottom lane here as well. Kickers will be trying to block him off. Get him zapping. Yeah, bodied. And Beansu will carry on pushing. So everyone's just going to go into a moment of calm for the next couple minutes.
Moment of calm. Is there ever a moment of calm in Challenger?
No, not really. It's basically the LPL of EU. Everyone just wants to fight all the time.
Look at this calm. Jazuki pushing everybody back. Interesting prospect, though, with that teleport not available for Beansu, but Kick is having it available. Could very well see a mid lane setup here, but Niski's going top lane, so probably not going to have too much happen just because of the way that, you know, Beansu can still interrupt Kick's TP. Kick is, because he hasn't itemized for this, is kind of just slowly losing health.
I think like the right term is eroded, like a cliff gradually gets eroded by water over many, many centuries. Beansu, though, is out of mana, so that's pretty much done for now. But he has pushed them out of lane, as much as that goes. Maokai not really great at pushing towers, though, unfortunately. So that pressure didn't really mean too much. So despite Kickers not really itemizing at all towards Beansu, he's never really going to feel the hurt of it, because Maokai's Maokai.
Oh, Gary just completed a recall in mid lane, and with a Cassiopeia, a Zyra, and an Elise, there is that tendency to think that you can go for Baron fairly early and not take too much damage from it, but you can see Taiki was around. Morales pushes him a little further back. That was the ultimate used by Jazuki.
Warning warp from Jazuki. Don't worry about it.
Oh, Fnatic. We've seen so many teams do this throughout the years. The can I can't I Baron call, where you're not quite sure, so you just sit there.
Followed by the NA Baron call, where you do this and maybe just get destroyed by Forge. Okay, pulling away. That's a good sign.
I mean, yes and no. It's a good sign as long as they refocus everything and go elsewhere. It's not a good sign if they lose the health and they go straight back to it and just go, okay, we're going to sit here. Luckily, they are going towards mid lane. They've seen Ryze topside with no ultimate available and also just saw Taiki recall out. So despite having a lead early on, Fnatic Academy, a little bit jittery about trying to close any more objectives out in their favor. Of course, they have lost some of that vision control that they had previously. The strength of Jizuki is enough to do that right now. If the Ash Arrow ever hits anybody and Jizuki's able to kind of appear with his ultimate, there is always that factor of Fnatic Academy overstepping again.
But this is often the stage in the game where a lot of amateur players would be like, I just don't know what to do. Like, what do you do at this point in the game? And often, the right answer is nothing, really. You just wait for a pick, someone to be out of position, you wait for a bit longer for like item spikes, and then you force a play. But at this point in time, there's no real objectives for Fnatic to really gun for until this dragon comes up in a minute. And until that point, it's like not like they can really realistically siege these inner towers. If they go Baron, they'll probably get wiped. So right now, it's just a waiting game.
Then we also have to kind of contrast that with what we were saying earlier, is these are not amateur players on the Fnatic Academy lineup. Kickis has won an EU-LCS split.
Yeah.
So I would expect him to be able to, you know, keep up with what the next play is on the game. Same could be said for Mr. Rally's years of experience in the EU-LCS. So maybe if they're not a primary shot caller, they should definitely be a voice. And I guarantee you Fnatic Academy have been in situations like this, whether it's in scrims, whether it is in, you know, competitive games as well. This should be the type of situation with a minor lead that they should be very used to, where they have to just play around Jizuki or, you know, one player that is significantly strong on the opposite team. They should be fairly comfortable with this compared to most teams.
Keyword should.
Should. Well, they got Marco.
Okay, that worked. That's fine. There you go. Marco goes down there. Nice pick from Fnatic. Just in time for Dragon.
And again, it's that rinse repeat on vision control. They finally found the you know, the time to go into the bottom side. Ryze was taking blue buff, so couldn't cross the distance. They knew it was safe to go deeper into the jungle. They get the pick. Now they can either look for mid tower. There goes an arrow just flying right through the bot side jungle. Looked like they were aiming for Rales, perhaps, or
not even sure what they were aiming
sure.
for, to be honest.
I saw an arcane shift.
Maybe hitting Dragon, perhaps, but even that was a bit wide. Either way, mid lane tower goes down to Fnatic, and they have broken that inner ring. And now Dragon is up, so it's just objective after objective. And 26 minutes for a fourth Dragon as well, that's pretty early.
What the Dragon attempt, though, from Fnatic will do is allow Taiki and Forge to clear out the vision control from around Baron. So they'll be able to get the Rift Scuttler, they can clear out the control ward. They shouldn't really attempt this. Fnatic, Binsu, you just TP'd in Kiggis' face. Broxa is around the Baron. Okay, good. Forge, pull back away from this. That was nearly a bit of a death sentence if Forge had fully committed to that, because Fnatic were closing in.
So I can commend them just a little, just for trying to find a play. It was a little slow, even if they were trying to go for it in the first place. As soon as Fnatic went for that, Dragon may have been the time for it, but they're just trying to find their way back in. And this reeks of desperation. 27 minutes in, it already feels like the noose is tightening with 3,000 gold advance to Fnatic. Those two towers, they're pushed so far into their base right now, and this will be a fifth Dragon. Plus an Elder, if Fnatic get to it. They took the first Dragon very, very early. It's very rare you see that, but Fnatic are just going to be massive. So 4G, they're really fighting the clock at the moment until they find a pick, but it's on Garry to try and land that, and it's very few targets who are easy to lock down. Your targets basically consist of Niski, maybe Broxar if he doesn't repel it, and again, Mr. Rallis, Arcane Shift on such a low cooldown, and very easy to see the arrow coming, so it's very hard to get that pick with Garry in the first place.
And the basis of this lead, you know, the massive amount of dragons that they're going to have if they can secure that fifth one in the Elder, it all stems from that starting play where, you know, Klai started the blue, they got the wolves down for Elise, and I'm expecting to see a lot more of this kind of thing when you've got Elise, Zyra, people thinking a little bit differently about how to take the jungle camps. And it's a good start. Fnatic Academy made that play, clearly had practiced it, and Forge just didn't read the gank attempt into the bottom side. So I really like the play out of Fnatic Academy. It's something that is very unorthodox compared to what we've seen before. Haven't really had too much of an opportunity. Oh, Klai!
Whoa, taken out as well. He just jumps right into the cone there from Mocha. The follow-up as well, the arrow. But Miasma will zone him away. Here comes a round warp, but didn't choose the right direction. Broxar was already out. Niski may be caught out, though. Jump over the wall from Beans. He will lock him down. The Twisted Van pops the ultimate. Niski still alive, putting damage onto Jizuki. He'll finally fall to the buckler there in from Kickers. And Taiki trying to limp away from this battle. Broxar back into the fight. Garry trying to do all he can, but even against the jungle, not really doing too much as Kickers jumps in there. That's the kill onto the ADC. And Mokka, unfortunately, behind enemy lines. He's being chased down by Ristorales. Nothing he can do about that one. Triple kill. Taiki, the only remaining member on this lineup, and Fnatic with three members strong. We'll see what they can do with this lead.
Oh, and it looked so good again at the beginning of that Forge. They catch out Klai, they take him down. They're able to, you know, combo a little bit more. And Jizuki went just maybe a step too far forward. He used the Realm Warp to try and catch out Niski, who survived for what seemed like an age in that fight. Got a lot of healing help from the rest of his team, but it wasn't quite enough. Forge actually ended up splitting themselves up from that team fight, and ended up getting Jizuki picked off fairly early on compared to the rest of his team. You can see now the rest of Forge are respawning as this Baron is going to go down. So Fnatic Academy, again, are able to turn the second half of the fight around because just how much damage Mr. Rales has. He had that Trinity Force for like the last 15 minutes of this game fairly early on, and he has just been punishing people as soon as he gets the opportunity to attack them.
Yeah, I think multiple members of this team, you can say, have just been monsters in this one. It all starts off with that pick on Klai. It's like, okay, good for Team Forge. And then, again, almost a second pick.
Broxa eats the arrow as well. It looks like at this point they're trying to box in Broxa and Niski, and Niski manages to connect with Taiki, connect a little bit of the damage down onto Jizuki here as well. The shields come through, the heal comes out. Jizuki just could not hang on, and the buckler out of Kickers was enough to take him down. And at this point, look, Beansu has three people around him. Taiki doesn't want to come into the fight. He's trying to heal up to just come back in, but it's not enough. Gary left all on his own, and Mugga has nothing to do from the top side of this fight. There is no crowd control there. He's only got the attempt of damage, and that doesn't really exist from this misfortune right now. So yes, you can try and shred people's armor off with a Black Cleaver, but that is not going to turn a fight when it's that late on and everybody's still very much healthy on the Fnatic Academy side.
Yeah, a little bit unfortunate there for Team Forge, just in general. Beansu makes it back to the base. There was a cocoon flying after him from Broxa. But 14-9, seems very difficult for Team Forge to come back into this game, but luckily, it is a best of five, so there is plenty more to come for them. And in game two, probably won't get blindsided by that play as well. To start it off, Gary completely caught out and deleted just from Kickers and Rallas alone. Jizuki being chased down, the big star carry of the team down for the count. Mokka following his ADC down into his death. And Broxar trying to find his next kill onto Beansu. But this is most likely going to be curtains on game one, with the first tower going down, followed by the inhibitor. And they have a nice juicy minion wave to follow them into the base. Beansu and Taiki, good luck, lads. Probably going to need it. Jumps onto Niski. We'll see if he can pick up this one kill. He is mild high. He's taking a lot of damage. Got that going for him, which is nice. Unfortunately, he is down. Mr. Rales will be the one picking up that kill, padding out his stats. Taiki will pad out his own stats by farming some minions before this game will end. And Fnatic onto the Nexus in game one in his best of five up against Team Forge, and take it in dominating style.
Very dominating game. A couple of mistakes, but generally Fnatic Academy looking very comfortable. And, you know, we talked about how would the bot lane fare. Mr. Rales, theoretically, you know, still, in my mind, could be mid-tier LCS AD carry.
A lot of people's mind.
Well, yeah, that's kind of what happened. A lot of help from Brox at the beginning of the game. Nobody expects the 2-minute 20 Elise.
Yeah, level
gang.
3 Elise going into bot lane. Everyone's level 1. It's like, oh, okay.
Nobody expects it from blue side either, yeah. Where you're like, oh, he's going to start blue and then he'll probably go up through the jungle and maybe go into mid. No, he's coming bot lane at level 3, which he's hitting around that 2-minute mark.
Yeah.
So I like the start of that game from Fnatic Academy.
I do too. But silver linings though for Team Forge, they should know that something like that could happen in game two now. So it's more likely that they'll start the game on an even playing field instead of starting a kill down, which really just started like that was the ripple that just like cascaded out of control in that game. So if you exclude that from game two, we'll maybe see more of an even game. And some of those plays that were coming out from Team Forge, which were pretty good, they had a couple plays that worked out for them, and maybe that will swing the game in their favor.
And Jizuki's looking like Jizuki still. Even though there was a lot of pressure on mid lane, still able to put up big numbers, so there's a lot more to come from this series.
Absolutely. So we'll see if they can do it. Fnatic have taken that game one, of course, over 4G in the European CSQ Spring Final. So after the break, we'll see if 4G can fire back. Stay tuned. Tar down into the bottom lane, looking for that vision onto Mocker and Gary. Kalai closing the noose as well. Vralas coming down. Might snare onto Mocker. Well, the flash after that will be the kill over to Vralas.
On that one.
Here comes Taiki trying to get this kill onto Kalai. The flash away may not save him, and well, indeed not. Taiki taking a lot of damage, Rallis, though. Might be the return kill. Vralas in there with a one for one trade. Moving on to Gary. The plant helping after the death as well. Rockstar comes in with the execute damage. Mocker getting chased down. The repel comes out. Neurotoxin is enough for that kill.
Beans coming through.
Putting them off, but this is Kiki's forcing the fight for Fnatic. Big ultimate in from Mocker. Unfortunately, it just does no damage. And that's two fast kills over to Fnatic.
We want to get blindsided by that play as well. To start it off,
Gary completely caught out and deleted just from Kickers and Rallas alone. Jazuki being chased down. The big star carry of the team down for the count. Mocker following his ADC down into his death.